look at conversations that happen in barbershops. I mean, I know guys that go to a barbershop just to argue about football, you know what I mean? But yeah, I mean, the way every man will express themselves in that shop, you just think everyone's on the top of their confidence levels, you know what I mean? Yeah. And you only find it in a barbershop, maybe a pub as well, but even in a pub it might kick off because of the influence of alcohol in there, you know what I mean? But a barbershop is where there's no beer, there's nothing. It's just a football game on the TV or a music video or a topic on women, you know what I mean? And men can freely talk.
And I'm not just saying hit that baller specifically, but I'm saying there's a lot of them.
Mm-hmm.
There's such egomaniacs where this is like, this is a different level of attention that the average guy isn't getting.
Yeah.
Right.
Exactly. And it's like,
it's new to them.
Yeah.
Like, oh, what? Yeah. Even barbers, like girls fight over me.
Yeah, they used to
teams
be girls.
Teams fight over me. Yeah. Now barbers fight over me as well. Guys in their 30s, they get invited by their friends to go out on a Saturday night to go for a drink or whatever. And he says, no, I'm not feeling it. And why is he not feeling it? Because where they're going, he's not allowed to wear a hat. And his hair's pretty much gone. And now he's living miserably because of his hair dilemma. But at the same time, does he want to go and get a transplant if everybody's going to look down on him?
Yeah.
And I can tell you from experience, they don't look down on you. The girls that they're with aren't putting out. Right.
Putting out what?
Like putting out.
Oh, what, like in bed?
Yeah.
Oh, wow. I thought they weren't cooking. Hey, my man's pushing the boat out there. Let's go, man. Let's go sailing, mate. Why not?
Okay, you ready?
I'm good to go.
We're rolling, ladies and gents, welcome back. My name is Badni Golau, owner of Alpha Male Barbers. Today I've got somebody with me who I've had on the show before, but the first time we did it was about 2 years ago during a lockdown. It was a Zoom episode, and I feel that it's always better to get an in-person podcast over a Zoom one. So with me today, I've got Theo from Barberstop UK.
Boom, 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 boom.
It's been a long time coming. He's been promising me for about 5 years that he was going to come see me at the shop. We finally got him here.
My road tax didn't take me this far, man.
It's a bit of a journey. This guy works hard. He's constantly moving around, constantly networking with barbers. But we've got him here. It's good to have these link ups and have these chats. For anybody that wants more of a background on Theo and the Barberstop UK agency, let's say, if you watched the first episode, we went more into detail. 2 years, what's gone on in 2 years, last 2 years?
Other than COVID, which we managed to dance. You know, to be fair, COVID did hit us in terms of our going abroad and, you know, the barbershop on the beach in Croatia,
right?
Portugal, we had Tenerife lined up, Ibiza, there was so much Malta, everything was lined up to do our pop-ups, you know, create content, go out there, backstage trims at the events, etc. So it kind of slowed that down. However, last year, everything that you see on our content wasn't planned.
Right.
It wasn't pre-planned.
That's a testament to what you guys have got going on, because so many barbers now want to be connected to you lot. So many people are interested, and you've got some of the bigger names in the industry, like they're starting to
take notice.
Yeah, they're starting finally.
They're recognizing.
Finally. And now, because you've got that ball rolling, people want you in certain places. People are asking you now, instead of you asking them, people are asking you to be there now. And people, you know, there's a lot of barbers that want to jump on and join and, you know,
get involved. It's you know, it's, we always promised to create a platform for barbers, you know what I mean? And I've always said, wherever you see Barberstop UK, there's going to be a barber there.
Yeah.
that we're highlighting, or there's going to be barbers that we're highlighting or showcasing, because I don't trim.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? And as much as people say, oh, you should trim, I feel like it was better to just focus on strengthening the brand.
Right.
So the barbers can do what they do, you know what I mean? So.
And this is something that, unlike a lot of barbering platforms, mm-hmm. you guys aren't there just to get the followers and the money and whatever else. No. Like, this is the reason why I'm so connected to you, is because this is the first and only barbering platform I've seen that actually seems to care about the barbers.
Yeah, because we're not, first of all, we never set up to make money. It was never a money thing to begin with. So I think that just automatically removed us from any sort of financial pressure or anything. We just wanted a platform where barbers can network. The events and festivals and Adidas shops and all this, that all was just started coming with it, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
But we genuinely, I take pleasure from hearing what you've just said there from barbers, you know what I mean?
No, that's true though, you know, you've got like some of these big barbering pages on Instagram that they just show haircuts from barbers with 10,000 followers and mm-hmm. whatever. Like, why does it matter how many followers a barber has for you to post a picture of their haircut? It's crazy. Nah. And you're the only platform I've seen that doesn't do that. What do you love about the barber industry? Like, why are you even here?
I get
why you started it, mm-hmm. and obviously you mentioned that on the last episode, mm-hmm. but what do you actually like? Because for me, and as we were talking before off camera, I'm invested because this is what I do for a living.
Mm-hmm.
It's different.
Mm-hmm.
You don't do this for a living.
No.
So why, what is it about?
You know what it is? I think it's the, I always looked at footballers as being the luckiest people in the world, because you get to wake up in the morning, jump in a Lamborghini, drive to training, play football for 4 hours or whatever, get in the gym, swimming pool, da 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 da. Go home and get paid like $100,000 every week to do it.
Yeah.
And I always think that's the luckiest job in the world, you know, and it's because you're in your element
right
every day, you know,
and
you can't beat that. But obviously from where my uncle back in days was a barber and watching, you know, how it all started and that, being amongst the barbers more and more is the energy that I don't get at work. Yeah, I mean, I don't get it anywhere, you know what I mean? So
okay. It's
real energy, and it's, we don't value people's energy enough in life because we're too busy doing XYZ. So
we're so focused on the work.
Yeah.
Like the human side of things is gone.
Exactly, yeah.
But obviously with our industry, the human side of it and the socializing side of it has to be there.
Mm-hmm.
But I think because we're all technically our own brands,
mm-hmm.
we've got to have the passion for it.
You got to have the passion for it, but also because you're all your individual brands, in the industry, there's a lot of let's not support him, or let's not like this, or let's not like his post, or he's done this, let's, because no one wants to show that another brand is bigger than theirs, or you know right. what I mean? There's this natural thing in nature where it's not jealousy, but it's more of a, why do I have to like his, or why do I promote, you know what I mean? But we're trying to eradicate that.
Yeah.
You're in Stafford, Romeo's in Liverpool. How many barbers in London, you know what I mean? So you should be able to share that energy,
course,
you know what I mean? Because it's like no one's stepping on anyone's toes.
There's millions
of people.
Yeah, they're not taking my custom and I'm not taking their custom. Exactly, you know what I mean? What's it matter?
But there's more to a barber than trimming. There's more to a barber than seeing what haircut he done or who he trimmed, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
You're a human being.
Yeah, you know
what I mean? We've spoken for about 3 hours before we even started recording because we've got so much to share, as you know what I mean? So it's encouraging that, you know, because one barber talking to you for 10 minutes could empower him, you know what I mean? So why not?
And I think as barbers, we're such like staples in the community, you know, and you've always got something to, we're the messenger, you know, somebody tells us a story and then the next guy comes and he needs advice. And the advice I've given, I've just picked up from the last guy in the conversation I've had with him, you know?
Yeah, so, exactly. Yeah.
But them two never would have spoke to each other.
That's it. And barbers are powerful. And again, that's another thing we also look at. We look at enhancing the respect that barbers get in general.
Yeah,
you know what I mean? The way people see barbers, he's not just that bloke you walk in, give him 20 quid and he trims you. He's a human being, you know what I mean? It's like, you know, I think barbers should be up there and then not up there, because there's been too much individualism. You know what I mean? And we take pride in bringing barbers together.
Yeah.
To create that.
Yeah. And I think when you look at, I think everybody in the, as an individual, if you're willing to spend the time to get to know them, everybody's got a story.
Yeah.
But I find with barbers, because we don't have to play by the same set as, of rules as a lot of industries and a lot of jobs play,
mm-hmm.
we get to be more authentic to ourselves.
Yes.
You get to know people for who they truly are, because if you work, I've heard it loads of times, people work in offices or they've got corporate jobs or certain specific, and they want to have an opinion and they don't because, oh, what if I post this on Instagram and my work picks it up?
Mm-hmm.
Like, fuck that.
Yeah.
Do you know what I mean?
They can't live free because they're bounded by...
Yeah, exactly. And we're not. We're basically... The only time we're at risk is if we upset our customers directly.
Mm-hmm.
But your opinion or your style or the way that you are
mm-hmm.
may put somebody off, but then it may bring in another two people.
Yeah, exactly. You know? So you can be yourself.
Yeah, yeah.
You know what I mean?
And you'll filter your customer.
Nine times out of ten, you've got to be really bad to put someone off or put a really far left or far right, whatever they say, you know what I mean? Comment on Instagram or, laugh at Kurt Zuma and say, yeah, you should have kicked the cat twice or something like that. You know what I mean? It's things that will obviously put you in a bad...
Right.
But in general, people buy you as a person, you know what I mean?
Yeah. And
that's why barbers got to be confident in themselves, you know what I mean? Because... that's the number one selling point itself.
But I think that's what makes the industry or the barbers themselves more interesting is mm-hmm. there's a lot more you can gain out of a barber because he doesn't have to play by those rules.
Nah, exactly. Yeah. He's not bounded by any rules or any red tape or anything, you know what I mean? He is him, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
He'll talk to you about whatever when you're in the chair, you know what I mean? And like a lot of people can find in their barbers, tell them secrets or have deep conversations with them because you know what I mean? They see you as a human being, you know what I mean? Yeah. So
we're connected. It's weird because we're connected to the world in a different way. Like we're connected to so many different clients and hear so many different stories. And at the same time, we're passing information back on. Mm-hmm. So we take information in and we pass it back out.
Yeah.
And if people want to know something in the area or whatever, they come to the barbershop, like people are like, have you heard about XYZ?
Yeah.
What do you know about this?
Mm-hmm.
You know, everybody wants to know the barber's opinion about what's going on the outside world because they know that we're the ones that have probably spoken to the most variety of people.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I don't know any other industry where you'll speak to that many different people in one day.
And
have actual conversation, not a high and a bye.
Yeah.
And a handshake, an actual conversation.
Yeah, because, I mean, you think about it, even a pilot, he won't get to speak to everyone on board. Taxi drivers, probably the closest you'll get to that can have a one-on-one conversation.
Maybe, but then how long?
Yeah, that's not, it's not long enough. And I don't know, it's about, you know, the sight of a customer in a barber chair and a barber trimming is such a traditional, it goes back years, you know what I mean? It's something that is part of, it's part of our lives, but not many people seem to
acknowledge it.
That's it. You know what I mean?
It's just like they've always been there. It's like we're a part of the furniture.
Yeah, exactly. You know what I mean? But then people still trust to speak to you. But it's like when the time comes and they want to talk to you, or if they're stressed and they're in the chair, they'll talk to you. You know what I mean? But they might not even talk to you again for another couple of weeks because you served their purpose at the time. You know what I mean? But again, like I said, people need to see barbers a bit more than that because... Bruv, you lot speak
but that's probably the most important thing, you know. It's a lot of the times people come to us and sometimes people say to me, do you know what, I didn't even really need a haircut, I just needed to kind of vent and get away from my problems for a little bit.
Yeah.
And so where do they come? The only place where they can come, where they feel comfortable to come, that isn't home.
Yeah.
You know, because sometimes the problems are at home, so they need to come elsewhere and listen
different environment
and speak to, you know, some friendly faces they know that actually give a shit, that aren't going to judge them.
Mm-hmm.
And here we are, you know, and we give them, like, in here, and I'd say a lot of barbers, but I can only speak for myself and my own shop, we are very honest with the way that we treat our customers. Like,
yeah,
a customer might tell us something, and even though we know he might not want to hear what we've got to say to him,
mm-hmm,
we're saying to him because we're trying to help this guy out.
Yeah,
do you know what
yeah,
I mean?
Being genuine.
There was a lad yesterday telling us one of his, like, a relationship problem. And we're kind of telling him things he knows deep down, but he probably doesn't want to hear.
Mm-hmm.
But he appreciates it because he knows that we're not trying to gain anything out of it. You know, it's just
the truth's the truth. You're being real with him.
Yeah, yeah. You know what I mean? But we don't have, because we don't know you outside the shop. We haven't got no hidden agenda.
Mm-hmm.
You know, mm-hmm, I'm not saying it to hate on you or fuck your shit up or whatever. Mm-hmm. I'm just saying it because I care about you. This is the real.
And that's exactly. And you, the funny thing is, you haven't been trained to be like that. You know what I mean?
No.
So you're not a psychologist that's maybe been trained to assess someone the same way they're going to assess the next 100 people they see. You know what
yeah.
I mean? You're just a guy that's relating to it, the next character yeah. that gets in your chair. You know what I mean? So it's like, oh, should I put my hand in this fire, bro? If you put your hand in that fire, you're going to burn your fingers.
Yeah.
Straight. Because
yeah.
you ain't got to be yeah. any other. You ain't gonna be, Mr. Oh, you may have a risk of burning yeah. your finger. No, you're straight up because it is what it is. You're real. There's nothing there. You know what I mean?
And people like that, you know, people, a lot of the time, I think people want, or they expect a formal type of response,
mm-hmm.
not from barbers, but from anybody else. You know,
yeah.
if you go to see a professional, you're going to get a formal response. Mm-hmm. They're going to write some notes. They're going to tell you generic things.
Yeah.
And I'm just, or barbers, we're just going to tell you what we think at the mm-hmm. time, take it or leave it. Do you know what I mean?
Well, look at conversations that happen in barbershops. I mean, I know guys that go to a barbershop just to argue about football, you know what I mean? But
yeah,
I mean, the way every man will express themselves in that shop, you just think everyone's on the top of their confidence levels, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
And you only find it in a barbershop,
maybe
a pub as well, but even in a pub, it might kick off because of the influence of alcohol in there, you know
exactly.
what I mean? But a barbershop is where there's no beer, there's nothing. It's just a football game on the TV or a music video or a topic on women, you know what I mean? And men can freely talk about women without upsetting them.
Yeah.
But they can be, you know what I mean? You can be in a restaurant, you'd be like, oh, women, this is, and then someone will hear him, he hates women. Yeah, no, you don't hate women.
Yeah.
He's just bending. Where else in life can you speak freely without offending people with, you know what I mean?
Yeah,
no,
yeah,
you know what I mean? And I feel like the barbershop is an unsung hero, man. It's
it's crazy, isn't it? Because until you're in it or you're in the industry, you've got no idea. Like a lot of customers say to us, in a lot of our clients say to us how they appreciate coming to the barbershop now because this is the barbershop they come to.
Mm-hmm.
Before, they go to a barber, he wouldn't talk to them, in and out,
mm-hmm.
and they didn't really appreciate it. It was just a haircut before.
Yeah.
Now it's like it's part of your like routine. It's
I mean, when you read history on barbering, I mean, it goes back way back. I mean, barbers used to be dentists at some point, you know what I mean?
Surgeons.
And you just think to yourself, when you read up on it, even the kings and the elders and that, they didn't really have many people to talk to because they were seen at the top, you know what I mean? So that barber was the one. It's like, for example, Ronaldo, how many people get to talk to Ronaldo one-on-one like this for an hour? You know what I mean? Even the interviews are like quick questions, fire out, like, he's got to go now, boom, boom, boom. You know what I mean? But can you imagine Ronaldo in the barber chair?
Yeah.
That barber's got him for an hour in his chair. You know what I mean? And they're not going to be silent.
Yeah.
But you see, that barber's got more of an opportunity than any pundit,
interviewer. We've got like the VIP access.
Yeah, because how much is a Ronaldo's time for an hour? Or Jay-Z's time for an hour? Yeah. Not that he cuts his hair, but you know what I mean?
Somebody's got to do it.
Yeah, you know what I mean? Yeah. And you're, that barber, you have that moment to yourself with that individual.
Yeah.
And if you get a conversation cracking, you learn so much from him. You know what I mean?
And that's what is so powerful about it, that people come and they know that for that moment of time, you've got my full attention.
Mm-hmm.
Right. So we can talk about whatever you want to talk about.
And this is weird trust with you guys as well. Like, guys, they trust you. They trust barbers have told me certain conversations that have gone on, not the individual, but the types of conversations they've had with their customers. And I sit and I think, wow, like, he's come and told you everything.
Probably.
You know what I mean? Where's that trust come from? He hasn't told his missus that.
Yeah.
But it's because you see that barber is that guy that knows everyone's business.
Yeah.
So he ain't on sharing anyone's business. You know what I mean?
I've had people tell me certain things, and I also trim their friends.
Mm-hmm.
And I said something that that person told me. I said it to their friend, assuming the friend knew, and the friend didn't know.
Mm.
But I knew, and I was like, oh shit. Like, yeah. How come me?
Mental.
And not them, you know?
Trust me.
I don't know. And that
is a weird energy, yeah? Where when the barber's got the tool in his hand and he's trimming you, I swear, if you're not careful, any question the barber asks you, you will answer it without even, filter, you know what I mean?
Do you think there's something to it? Because at that point, you're sat in a chair, you're facing forwards, I've got a task to do. You're sat down, I'm stood up, there's a gown on you. Mm. You're in a kind of vulnerability.
Yeah, it's like you're in control sort of thing.
I'm in control as a barber and you're not, right? Not in a weird way, but I think you just kind of like, you sit there and you obey.
Yeah, that's it. And it's, I don't know how it happens, but it happens, you know what I mean? And you cannot, a barber will ask you a question, you cannot ignore him.
Where are you going to go?
Exactly, yeah, you're stuck in the chair, half a trim, you know what I mean?
Exactly, and the fact that you don't look at us in the face, I think that's like psychologically, that's got something to do with it. Because you don't look at us in the face, you look at us through the mirror.
Yeah.
You're not looking at me now and there's pressure and I'm staring straight at you. Yeah. I'm looking at the side of your head.
Yeah.
And you're looking at me through the mirror and we talk.
Yeah. It's weird. I'm telling you, there's an energy that we can't see it, brother. The barbershops and the connection between the barber and the customer is underrated. That's the phrase. It's underrated.
I believe that. Now, there was something that was going on not too long ago that you were really enjoying, you know, on the WhatsApps and the Instagram, where we had a footballer switching between barbers.
Oh, my days,
Now, so for those that don't know, a certain footballer, he was getting a trim from somebody, a big name in the industry, and then he ends up in another barber's chair, and it looked like that barber then was taking shots at the other barber.
Yeah.
But then this footballer goes back to the original barber, and the original barber redoes his trim, and what it seemed from the outside is that that footballer is knowing he's getting a lot of attention off the barbers and the barbers following, and he's stirring something up between the barbers, because one barber's taking a shot at another barber, which before they were trimming this guy, they weren't taking shots.
Exactly. And it's,
what do you think about this kind of stuff in the industry?
You know what? First of all, I think barbers put in a lot of work to build a brand. Yeah. So when you see certain brands or certain barbers going at each other indirectly like that, you know what I mean? Because of one footballer.
Yeah.
It's a bit of a shame, you know what I mean? Because A, it's not good for the younger barbers coming up.
Right.
Because it's like, oh, if you don't trim Phil Foden or him or her or whatever,
you're nothing.
Yeah, you know what I mean? You're not progressing. Like, it shouldn't be like that, you know what I mean? Yeah. I mean, these footballers do not give a toss.
Yeah.
Excuse me, I don't even know if I can say the barbers. They don't. That's why they jump in every chair. You know what I mean? Yeah. They don't care about you. You know what it is? I'll tell you the secret, yeah? Footballers know that you're gagging for that content.
Yeah.
They know you're gagging for that content. so you know what? You're already a slave to them. Yeah. That's why they'll come in and they'll expect not to pay. Yeah. Or they'll expect you to close your barbershop for them, you know what I mean, or move a client just for them, because they know you're gagging for that content. That's the best content you're gonna get all year. Now bun that, come on, man.
Yeah,
you know what I mean? It's not real. They're taking advantage of you. Do you see what I mean? It's a shame. Some of the barbers are too advanced to be worrying over this, man. Who put a do-rag on him? Who didn't put a do-rag on him? Yeah. Who put a line in his hair? Who dyed his hair better? Yeah. Come on, man. Yeah.
But that footballer is so like, and I'm not just saying hit that baller specifically, but I'm saying there's a lot of them.
Mm-hmm.
They're such egomaniacs where this is a different level of attention. that the average guy isn't getting.
Yeah.
Right?
Exactly. And it's like,
it's new to them.
Yeah.
Like, oh, what? Yeah. Even barbers, like, girls fight over me.
Yeah, they used to
teams
be girls.
Fight over me. Yeah. Now barbers fight over me. You know what I mean?
And then he's sat there smiling. Like, he's like, they must laugh about it in training.
Of course.
You know what I mean? Yeah. I know they laugh about it in training. But there's barbers out there trimming that aren't showing you 90% of the A-listers they're trimming.
Yeah,
you know what I mean? Like I always say, and I always use them as an example because I've seen it firsthand from Romeo, you know what I mean? Where he will show you text messages of certain people that are messaging him for trims. And I'm like, right, you trim him.
Yeah.
And he's like, yeah, man, but I don't post it. You know what I mean? Because
Romeo
said something really smart once to me. He goes, why should I show you my whole clientele? Yeah, it's actually risky for client. Also, you protect a client's privacy, you know what I mean?
Oh, confidentiality.
Yeah, because you see barbers at the gate of Premier League footballers' houses, you know what I mean? Every single day, every player that he's... I knew where half of the footballers live just from one barber.
Yeah.
Now, if I had any bad intention...
Yeah, I get
if it. I wanted to do a madness...
Yeah.
Yo, Van Damme, you trim blah, blah, blah. Yeah?
Yeah.
Take me to his yard now. Otherwise, I'm going to go to your yard and grab your kids.
Yeah.
It's true. I mean? It's dangerous. Level, That's why certain barbers, they're not allowed to tell you who they trim.
Right.
You know what I mean? There's agreements written. You know what I mean? Like Ego Barbers, Harry.
Yeah.
I remember when I was talking to him once, when we first started the barbershop, and he was like, there's people I trim. I'd love to tell you who I trim.
Yeah.
Because I know you'd love it, but I can't tell you.
Jeez.
You know what I mean? He can't even tell his wife.
That's mad.
So don't get gassed on these footballers. They don't rate you,
man.
But
this is why, like, certain barbers, like, as you said, Romeo's one. Franklin's another one. They've built their brands, and if you're a baller and you've got a lot of money and you've got a lot of fame and whatever else, they're so set up, and they're so like, no, they're going far with or without you, that if you don't want to sit in my chair, fine, see you later,
bro.
But these barbers that are like, they're like sharks on these ballers, and the ballers are like playing it, like, you know,
listen,
wrapped around.
You know what needs to happen? I was someone sent me a picture once, and a player just signed for Chelsea, and he had a barber that was trimming him, I don't know how the barber got in connection with him.
You know the barber?
I know the barber. Oh, I know the barber. I mean, he trims for Frank. He trims at FFA.
Okay.
And I don't want to say too much, but to think that one barber will go behind another barber's back and message his client.
Yeah, dead.
You know what I mean? If I know that you're trimming this guy and I'll go behind your back, whether we're friends or not, I'll go behind your back and message him. It's like, it don't need to happen. That needs to stop.
But you know what that is?
But you know what you know what should happen? Sorry to cut you. They should be named and shamed.
Yeah.
Throw it out there and be like, yo, Joe Bloggs just messaged my client, trying to get a trim. Put that up there, post it on your story, send it to Barbershop, we'll post it, because you know what, that will stop that. Because you know what, bruv, you may have a brand, Alpha Male Barbers, and everyone knows it, and everyone across the world, but you're doing these sneaky things behind the back, people's backs, you know what I mean? It's like, bruv, no, the industry should be clean.
But the thing is, they're like, it's funny because they're personality traits that people don't like in general. So you normally see it with, like I said before, you normally see it with girls. So you're chatting to a girl and then I know that you're chatting to her, but I'm trying to move in, right? And people don't respect that trait, but we're seeing it in the barber game as well.
Yeah.
And so if that trait isn't respected outside barbering, it sure as hell ain't respected in barbering.
You know what I mean? And you know what hurts me the most, bro? And it directly impacts what we try to do. Now, we're trying to build a connection, a network of barbers that trust each other. Oh, how do you do that fade, bro? Oh, you do it like this. Oh, bruv, how did you get to trim that football team? Oh, you know, I sent an email to him or I spoke to their secretary. Or, you know what I mean? But people don't want to share that now because there's so many snakes out there.
Yeah.
You see what I mean?
Yeah.
And these snakes... You know, I don't get, you know what, why would Ferrari go and nick Audi's designs?
Yeah.
You're Ferrari.
Yeah, yeah,
you
don't
need to.
Yeah, you don't need to.
You see what I mean?
Yeah.
You're in your lane, he's in his lane, you know what I mean? And I don't know, man. But you know what, there's real ones amongst, there's more real barbers than Nerado sharks, you know what I mean? And that's good.
Yeah,
but yeah, you got my blood boiling in that one, boy. But yeah, man,
it's a funny industry because again, a lot of like regular day to day people that aren't connected in the industry
mm-hmm.
have no idea this happens.
No,
you know. But then when you get into it, you're like, oh, okay, it's like
yeah,
that.
Yeah, bro. People send me stuff. I get barbers send me stuff. Yeah, they're like, bro, look what this barber's done. But just out of respect for the other barber and the fact that I don't want to create beef.
Mm, yeah.
I don't post it. And I tell them, I'm like, bro, I can't post this, bro, because it's going to get, they're like, yeah, but you're media for the barbers, man. You should be exposing it. And I, you know, they put me on the spot sometimes. I'm like, you know what? You're right. And I should, because Sky News will put it on if it was.
Yeah, but Sky News, we don't know the owner of Sky News.
Exactly. You see what I mean? You see what I mean? But it's like, sometimes you want to post it to keep the game real. But at the same time, we've got to be careful because we're out there for all barbers, you know what I mean? So
yeah.
We don't want to be seen as a platform that would like to create beef, or create animosity or something. We'll speak on the topic.
And sometimes it's like you've only heard one side of the story.
Yeah.
You know, you speak to that other barber and he might have a different take on it. And he might not be doing something maliciously, but that other barber's got offended. Yeah. Like, I've got a client who's just started coming to me and he used to go to a barber shop in a different town.
Mm.
And I'm friends with the owner of that barber shop. And the guy's just started coming to me because he's closer to me. That's it.
Mm-hmm.
Not any disrespect to the other guys. But I'm not trying to worm my way in.
Mm-hmm.
I'm here if you want me. If you don't, cool. Yeah, or if you just want me in an emergency, cool.
Yeah.
Or whatever. But some people could take offense and, you know, get sensitive because, obviously, as you're not a barber, I'm sure you do understand it, but it's embarrassing to say, really, but it does hurt when your clients, someone that you've been trimming for a while, leaves.
Yeah, I don't think it should be embarrassing, but I get what you mean.
But it's weird. It's a weird feeling.
It's like a woman leaving you and going for someone else, and you know the person. You all live in the same town, and he's living right across the fucking road from you. You know what I mean? Like, and it's mad. But you know what it is? It's natural because, okay, put the money aside. Yeah, collectively,
it's not about the money.
But you've built a relationship with that person. Yeah, you know what I mean?
Put your time into it.
Yeah, and plus you'll question yourself, why has he gone?
Yeah,
you know what I mean? It's just like if a woman got up and left you, you'd be like, what is it that
have I
done something wrong? What was she not happy? Yeah. How long was she not happy for? You know what I mean? What's the other guy doing that I wasn't doing? You know what I mean? So it's like, it's loads of factors because remember, and this is why I say, forget these ballers because the 10 people that come and see you every couple of weeks or whatever, they're rotational, you know what I mean? You're building a relationship with them.
Yeah.
Ronaldo will leave, sign for someone else and never talk to you again, fam. You know what I mean?
Unless you chase
him to the other country and start trimming him there.
Exactly.
Which wouldn't even make sense, unless he's paying you a grand for the haircut. It don't even make sense, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
I'm sure most of these barbers jump on the plane for promo stuff, you know what I mean? Because it don't make sense. How much are they paying you to be flying there, you know what I mean? So, but that's your hustle. I don't knock it. But at the end of the day, it would hurt, you know what I mean? Yeah, it's one of those. If a barber unfollowed me, I'll be like, rah, what did I do wrong? You know what I mean? So it slightly feels embarrassing, but at the same time, it's like I see how emotional it could get a barber.
Yeah,
you know what I mean?
Because you think as a grown man, I shouldn't be bothered about that stuff. But from time to time, not with every customer, but certain ones, you're like, ooh, that one hurt a little bit.
Yeah, yeah.
you know what I mean?
Yeah.
But again,
you thought you had something good with them, you know what I mean?
Yeah. But it doesn't mean it's anything wrong on your behalf. Like sometimes I haven't seen a client for 6 months. I'm like, fuck, I must have pissed him off. I must have done something, fucked up his dream. I don't know.
Yeah.
And then he turns back up and you're like, what happened? Where have you been? And he's like, oh, I've been working away. It's like, oh, that's it.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
And there was me in my head thinking, you know,
like you done something wrong. Yeah, bro. It's hard, man. It's hard because barbering is a very personal. When the sky man comes to your house, sky engineer comes to your house and fixes a satellite or swaps your remote over or gives you a new, he's in and out.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? And you won't see him again until your sky goes wrong again. And even that, it might be a different engineer. But your barber, he's the same guy you're gonna see. So it's a totally different relationship you build. You know what I mean? Even your dentist, you don't see him that much.
Nah.
You see what I mean?
Once a year, twice a year.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So yeah, no, definitely, man. I could understand how a barber would get a bit touchy if someone left him or didn't turn
it's
up.
Mad. Another subject that I don't know anybody that speaks about this publicly, but I saw something on a meme page that kind of sparked me to want to speak about it more.
Mm-hmm.
So in October, for anybody that doesn't know me or those that do know me that didn't know, me and my brother got hair transplants, right?
Okay.
Now, I only decided 4 or 5 weeks before I got the transplant that I was getting it done.
Mm-hmm.
So it was just one of them things. My hair was receding a bit, but I used to cover it well. Loads of most people that know me were like, if not everybody that knew me was like, you don't need a hair transplant. But I was I managed to cover it well because my hair's thick,
yeah,
but it was just going further back. And then I pulled my hair back and I was like, shit, it's further back than I want it to be.
Mm.
And obviously hairlines don't grow forward.
Yeah.
So I wasn't desperate, but I thought my brother's going already. So I may as well go now before I'm desperate. Now, I'm not the kind of person that really cares about other people's opinions.
Mm-hmm.
So I came back from having the transplant and we came back to the UK on the Thursday and Friday I was back in the air trimming.
Right? Yeah.
You can't wear a hat for the first 10 days.
Mm-hmm.
So I couldn't cover it. So I've got a head full of scabs. I've got missing hair at the back where they've taken the hair from. I look like a fucking train wreck. You know
yeah,
what I mean?
Yeah.
I was getting some funny looks. Like some of my customers knew I was going because I'd seen them before I went.
Yeah.
Others didn't know, and they were kind of looking at me, and I was just being open with them. I've had a hair transplant. They're like, oh, no way. And they were interested. They're asking me about it. The amount of guys that told me, actually, I'd like it done.
Mm.
Was really surprising. But the reason I bring it up is because a lot of guys are so embarrassed of talking about it. A lot of guys are so embarrassed to say that they're paranoid that their hair is going, or they feel like they might want a hair transplant, or they are going to get one, or they have one and they don't tell people they've had it.
Mm-hmm.
All of this. And I couldn't get away with it because I needed to come back to work.
Yeah.
And I can't hide it. So basically I've got to tell you.
Yeah.
But I'm not the kind of person that is bothered anyway.
Mm.
And to be fair to my younger brother, he's not bothered either. I know people that have had transplants that don't want to come out of the house until their hair's grown back. People that are super paranoid, they feel embarrassed to tell people. And then on a meme page, I think it was I'm Just Bait, probably a week or 2 weeks ago, I don't know if you'd seen the video, but somebody had filmed, they were coming back from Turkey
and oh my god they're playing full of
funny. So if you go to Istanbul or you're going to Turkey, you know, going through the airport, it is the craziest thing. Like so many, like you walk around with your head bandaged up. It's not weird. Like everybody's either had a transplant or getting a transplant, right? But it was the caption that kind of pissed me off because the person, whoever's managing the account was like, he was kind of looking down on it and he said something along the lines of, to be honest, if it comes to that, I'll just shave it all off. But it was like a stab at it.
Yeah.
And I didn't like it because, again, I'm exempt from what I'm saying here because I don't give a fuck.
Yeah.
But there's a lot of guys that do.
Mm-hmm.
And just because you don't, you might not be willing to have a transplant. Mm-hmm. You're not interested, you can't afford it, you don't think it's worth the money, whatever it is. But just because that's your opinion, looking down on other people, what it does is it makes men more embarrassed to get it done. And again, it's not, if you look down on it, for example, it doesn't bother me because I don't care.
Mm-hmm.
But that might stop another guy who, and I'm talking from experience when I deal with it in the shop.
Yeah.
There's guys that tell me, guys in their 30s, they get invited by their friends to go out on a Saturday night, to go for a drink or whatever. and he says, "No, I'm not feeling it." And why is he not feeling it? Because where they're going, he's not allowed to wear a hat, and his hair's pretty much gone, and now he's living miserably because of his hair dilemma. But at the same time, does he want to go and get a transplant if everybody's going to look down on him? And I can tell you from experience, they don't look down on you, but when you've got people putting their fucking two cents in it,
that's it,
right?
And you've got big pages on social media,
but the same pages that talk about when something happens at the time, something big happens, there's I don't know, a suicide, a big mental health story, men's mental health, blah blah blah, we all need to stand by each other, but
it.
You're gonna trash. Girls can get their lips done, their tits done, their asses done, their hair done, Botox and whatever else. Guy can't have his hair grow back.
It's see, social media is a savage world, isn't it? It's all by trend, you know what I mean? Everyone that hates marijuana will start loving it when it's legalized. You see what I mean? It, all it takes is a change, and a change of opinion or change. It's all it is. And you got double standards in social media. A lot of platforms, they'll post this and then they'll post that, and it's they contradict themselves all the time. You know what I mean? And it's a shame, because it's a vicious cycle that drives attention. You know what I mean? And it's like, let's insult them and make fun of them. But oh, you know what? Yeah. If someone went and killed themselves because they were so, like, conscious of their looks and that, we'll then say, oh my God, I can't believe he's gone. He had kids. It's like you're living a double life. You know what I mean? But it's we're always saying men should speak more, but then men can't do things freely. You know what I mean?
Without at getting
the end
trashed.
Of the day, at the end of the day, someone's gonna buy a pair of trainers because that's what makes them feel like yes, that's what I've got. You know what I mean? Someone will go to the gym and pump up. You know what I mean? Because that's what makes them feel confident. You know what I mean? We all have to feel confident in order to be the best that we can be.
Yeah.
Do you see what I mean?
Yeah.
And you can't stop someone. There's something that Ronaldo does that keeps him confident. You know what I mean? There's something that Lewis Hamilton does that keeps him confident. You know what I mean? It's because they need to keep that confidence level up.
Right.
You know what I mean? You can't be depressed because of your hairline.
Yeah.
You see what I mean? I'm lucky. I've got my hairline's mad. But I actually liked the look of when I was bald.
Right.
I thought, right, you know what I mean? It brought the beard out more when the beard's trimmed out. You know what I mean? I thought, oh, you know what? It's a new look for me. Right. And I embraced it. I was scared about what people were going to do. What? You're bald. You know what I mean? Yeah. Rather than, oh, your hairline. You know what I mean? So I took a risk going that way. You know what I mean? And I love it.
Mm.
You see what I mean? So to anyone out there that's thinking about it, don't think about people, you know, all right, cool, it's peak because you're coming back with a bandage around your head and you're walking through an airport and you might not like, some people don't like attention.
Yeah,
so it might be
I get that. I get that.
You know what I mean? But don't let them put you off, mate, because if you lose your confidence, then what else you got in life?
Yeah,
you
you're living in misery just because of somebody's opinion.
Yeah, exactly. And not being funny, it's not even a bad thing. They're taking hair from one part and putting it in the other bit.
You know
what I mean? Yeah. Women are getting unknown substances injected into, not that there's anything wrong with it, but look at that risk factor.
Yeah.
I mean, but implants.
But people have less to say about that.
You know what I mean? But I move one hair follicle from here to there and I'm a bad guy. I'm an idiot. Come on, man. It's just, people just want things to talk about.
It's crazy though, isn't it? Because the thing is, as barbers as well, I think we should definitely encourage it.
Yeah.
Because I've been shocked at how many guys confident, if you really speak to him about it, how many guys' confidence get knocked from their hair.
Mm-hmm.
Do you know what I mean? Mm-hmm. It's receding a bit. They're like, oh shit, is it starting to go thin here?
Yeah.
Do you know what I mean?
Men are vain when it comes to hair. I thought, I didn't know till I got into Barberstop UK deep, and you know what I mean?
Yeah.
Realized speaking to barbers, getting feedback from what customers are like, and seeing guys in the mirrors and that, you know what I mean? And it's like, it's a big part of a lot of men's life, you know what I mean? So, and it's your appearance, you know?
Yeah. And I don't know, I found it mad how so many people came to me and they were like, where did you get it from? How much was it? What's the procedure? Does it hurt? Blah, blah, blah. I'm thinking of getting it done. None of them said it to me before.
Mm-hmm. But as soon as you've done it.
Yeah. Now they're like, oh shit, this is a young guy who's a barber, who's had it done, who's freely speaking about it.
Mm-hmm.
So if he's not bothered, why should I be bothered?
That's it. That's it. And like I said, the process, there's nothing embarrassing about the process. So, and it's the fear to go and ask anyone else, because they don't want to be seen as, oh, well, he's thinking of getting a hair transplant. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
He thinks he's going to be the talk of the town. Like, nah, but because you've done it and they confident speaking to you already, it's like, and that's how things work out. You know what I mean? And it's good because it puts you in a good position to give these people confidence to just go and do it, bruv. You know what I mean? Don't speak to anyone else because they're just going to give you all this. They're based on society. You know what I mean? Oh my God, people are going to look at you funny. Oh, da, 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 what about, oh, you're already bald or whatever. You know what I mean? Nah, cool, leave yeah. it. You know what I mean? Go and do what you want to do, man.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? It's, bruv, trust me. I know for a fact, if I didn't like the way, if I didn't like the bold look, I definitely would have taken it as an option. Definitely. Yeah, yeah, because I'm thinking, bruv, when the hairline's got today, what the hell am I doing? You know what I mean? Like, I need to reverse that shit. Yeah. You know what I mean? But now, man.
I think women should also be encouraging it, because if you can get the best out of a guy by his confidence being boosted up, because anybody with low self-esteem, man, woman, kid, whatever, they're not the best version of themselves.
No.
And in a perfect world, we're all the best version of ourselves, and everybody's, and the world's better for it. But if you've got all these people that are miserable and low self-esteem and whatever else, and women start encouraging it and say, I think all guys that are going through that situation should consider it. Maybe guys would feel more confident to do it because they're not going to be scrutinized for it.
Yeah, and you know what? You're right. I mean, it's a weird thing, isn't it? It's like, because they're opposite sex, and naturally a woman that you like, you want to impress them more, you know what I mean? So it's like, with that woman, it's cool with something about you, you can naturally feel a bit more relaxed,
right?
You know what I mean? Like, it's like,
if she's cool with it, I don't care about anybody else.
Yeah, it's like when I first chipped my tooth.
Yeah.
And no, not when I first chipped. I chipped it, had it done, then I chipped it again playing football.
Right.
And then the dentist was like, come back when you're 23 or something to get it recrowned or something. I never went back, you know what I mean? But then the girl I was seeing at the time was like, oh my God. I was paranoid about it.
Yeah.
And the girl I was seeing at the time was like, oh my God, you remind me of Fabulous. He's got a chipped tooth. I was like,
you never thought that. Not that I went
skipping around in the road going, yes, come on, man. But in my head, it slightly made me feel a little bit more comfortable because I was like, hold on, that Fabulous is, oh my God, yeah, he has got a chipped tooth. He's been rapping all the time. And he even says it in one of his songs, you love me no matter how chipped my tooth is, or something like that. You
know, J. Cole spoke about that as well.
Oh, did he?
Yeah, J. Cole basically said, like, I quote, it's called Crooked Smile.
Oh.
And he said, but he was basically saying about, like, your flaws are your flaws, and I could have it done, but I want you to kind of want me for me. So here you go. But at the same time, it sounds like we're contradicting ourselves, because the hairline moving back is you, but it depends on what you're happy with doing.
Yeah.
You know, if something makes you miserable and you can fix it, go and fix it.
Yeah.
But if you're not bothered about it, then cool, you carry on.
Yeah.
You know, but don't act like you're not bothered about it because you're too embarrassed to seem like you're bothered about it.
Yeah, exactly.
Which is what a lot of people are doing.
Yeah, yeah.
Oh, you know, I'll just shave it off. And then people, I used to hear people say that, like, in conversations about hair transplants, like, fuck that. If when my hair starts to go, I'll just shave it. And now we've come to a point where they've seen me with mine, and they're like, that hairline is sick. And they're like, oh, I'm going to go and have mine done.
Yeah.
You know, but
because they don't want to walk around bald now. You know what I mean? Yeah. There's an option for them now.
The opinions change now.
Yeah.
You know, but before it was like, oh yeah, I'm too good to say one.
I always said, I was speaking to, over the last 3-4 years, I've been speaking to a lot of barbers that were trying to get into the whole headpiece, head unit business, talking themselves about learning how to do the transplants or some of the treatments, etc. And I always knew it would trend, but it needed more men to do it, because men have got this whole pride thing. But the more guys that, I mean, the head units thing, I'd personally rather get the head transplant than the hair unit thing, because I don't know, in the back of my head, the whole it's glued on my head thing,
I don't know.
And I've seen, who was it, oh, there's this video of this Chinese family eating or something, and I don't know if the guy took his hat off or he took his hoodie off, but his thing flipped back like that, but he didn't realize,
you know what
I mean, until someone else is done, and then he's put it back down, you know what I mean, so that makes you paranoid, you know what I mean. And I feel like the hair transplant is a natural growth, You know what I mean? They're removing it from here to there and it's growing naturally. Yeah. So you can't go wrong. Yeah, it might look painful or you might have to live a certain way, but bruv, what, a few weeks with a few scars and to bring your hairline back?
I'm like 4.5 months in now and people are like, oh, it looks good, you know? So
you see what I mean? So don't be shy out there, man. Come on, man. Bro, listen, people, wait, do you know what people waste money on?
Oh, trust
just
me.
Just to make them feel happy. For you're going to go to a strip club and give a chick £500 just so she can whine you for like 20 minutes, bro. £500, fam. Like, it's done. Yeah. You're gone. You can't even touch her. You can't even touch her. But next man goes and gets hair transplant so he can get his hairline back and he's the idiot.
Yeah.
Come on, man.
So yeah,
people waste money. And you know what? I started looking at life like that only a few years ago, where I used to think, why should I feel bad about doing this? He spends that on that. He spends that on that. Yeah. Everyone does what they do to keep themselves happy, bro.
Yeah.
And that's life. Like you said, why be miserable?
So true. Swing it around a little bit before we close up. What I try and do is sometimes with certain customers, certain guests, I try and bring a conversation from the barbershop that I've had. And just kind of bring it to light here. Now, they always seem to end up being relationship problems.
Oh, right.
Because that's the environment we're in. Guys, like we said, feel safe to come and tell us their problems.
Mm-hmm.
I put it on my Instagram yesterday. And this is starting to become a bit of a normal, not a normal thing, but a more common thing. And as we're here and it's a barbershop type of podcast, it's a conversation in the barbershop, but what it shows is it's relevant to society now and it's relevant to men at the minute. Mm-hmm. So that's why I'm bringing it up. I'm not going to mention names, but I've had two lads now in the last 3-4 weeks, they're in their 20s. Mm-hmm. Some of them early 20s, other ones a bit older. Engaged, both of them coincidentally engaged, but I don't know if that has anything to do with it. And the girls that they're with aren't putting out. Right.
Putting out what?
Like putting out.
Oh, what, like in bed?
Yeah.
Oh, wow. I thought they weren't cooking. Hey, my man's pushing the boat out there. Let's go, man. Let's go sailing, mate. Why not? Okay.
So,
and they're engaged.
Well, but they're saying like once every 3-4 weeks. Now, they're in situations now where these guys are coming in depressed. So I thought the first time I heard it, I was like, might just be that situation. Then I heard it again yesterday. And then a friend of mine yesterday told me he's read something, an article about millennials now.
Mm.
And they're not into sex as much because it's so, it's just become so normal. You know, we see naked people and half naked people everywhere and whatever else.
Mm-hmm.
But the situation is, this is happening and guys are like so paranoid to speak out about it.
Yeah.
And they think it's just them. And now we're actually seeing a trend.
Boy, you know what? You know, it's okay. It's it's a problem, isn't it? If that sort of a problem, especially when you're heading towards the whole marriage thing.
Yeah.
It's dangerous. You know what I mean? Because especially the man, you know, men, where if you go to nature, if she's not putting out, your eyes are going to start wandering, because naturally, and it's not intentionally mentally, but naturally your body's going to start calling for it.
Yeah.
That's when a chick walks past the shop, she's got a bit of a back and you're like, rah, you know what I mean? And then you're thinking, I haven't even seen my own chick's back for how, like, you know what I mean, 3 weeks, why, you know what I mean? It's a dangerous game for the women to play, but me personally, I think them guys should be really honest with the girl.
Mm.
And just be like, you know, our sex life isn't really there. But then that's where you run the risk of, why should I really ask for it?
Yeah. So the one was saying like, he's addressed it,
mm-hmm.
and she's like, oh well, you know, we've got a house now and we've settled down. Like, why do we need to keep doing this? And it's like, what? But he was like, I don't, it's not even about the actual sex. Mm-hmm. It's the affection side of it as well. Like, yeah, I just want her to want me.
Yeah.
Without having to tell her to want me.
Me personally, I would, and this is why, see, marriage, I've got a really, not that, like, the missus always gives me grief. She's like, you don't like marriage. It's not that I don't like marriage, yeah? But it's like, a lot of people go down this route without really knowing what they're dealing with.
Mm.
You can't take a car and rag it down the country road when you don't know what the suspension's like, what tyres it's running on, what the accelerator's on, what the brakes like. You know what I mean? You almost have to test drive a relationship. You have to get used to a person because, bro, now you're at a situation, yeah, where it's like, she's not showing you any affection, but you're engaged.
Yeah.
And you know, when you get married, it's 10 times worse, you know, because then there's more stress, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
I wouldn't go any further. Well, personally, I wouldn't, because I'm only going to cheat on you.
Well, this is the thing. So, like, the reason why a lot of guys do cheat, and again, I'm not condoning any of this.
No.
But the reality is, like you said, naturally, and there's actually, we're not, you know, we seem like we're just talking about guys, but naturally, mm-hmm. there's a lot of women that want it regularly as well. And if the guy's not putting out, she's going elsewhere too.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
There's a lot of women that cheat, and they say their man always works away and they never mm-hmm. see him, and then mm-hmm. they go elsewhere.
Yeah.
So the thing is, if you're having problems now, early on, and if you have the conversations and then things start to improve, cool. But if they don't, you can't just live with it.
No.
Because you can't.
You're just living for the sake of it, you know what I mean?
And then in 5-10 years time, you're like, do you know what? I've had enough.
If you've got a high sex drive and your missus hasn't acknowledged that for a whole 2 years that you've been together, then you can't be with that woman, because you will always be sexually frustrated. And no one encourages cheating, but this is why men cheat or women cheat, like you said, because there's something imbalanced, you know what I mean? And there's something they're not happy with.
Yeah.
You see what I mean? And it's like, boy, it's like,
what do you want the guy to do at this
point? Exactly. Yeah, exactly. You know what I mean? That's why for me, for a guy, bro, life is too short. And so many men have thrown their lives away for the sake of a woman. So many women have thrown their lives away for the sake of a man that's not really involved. You need to be happy, bro. You know what I mean? And if the woman can talk about it, then good.
Yeah.
But again, it's how you bring that up and have that conversation.
Because it's mad, because you could be like, 5-10 years down the line, and then you're like, do you know what, I'm not happy anymore, I'm going. Cool. But the red flag was there from 5-10 years before.
Exactly.
If you went when you should have gone, you'd probably been in something good by now.
Yeah. And there's some women that genuinely will feed their men with that emotion, sex, whatever it is, you know what I mean? They'll make sure they're there because they want to keep that guy.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? And they don't want that guy going elsewhere.
Yeah.
You see what I mean? So whatever it is, like my missus always says, we should always be able to talk about things, communication. She's a big one, and she goes, a good relationship, is where a man or woman can talk about anything, or they can bring anything to the table and talk about it openly. And I think that's what you need to look at in a woman before you even go down the route of buying her a ring or anything. You know what I mean? We've both got to test drive each other.
Mm,
you know what I mean? True. Otherwise, you'll never know if it's the right whip for you.
Yeah. It's true.
Yeah, man.
Men, boys.
Bruv,
take notice.
Trust me, man. And you know, a Jamaican woman taught me that. Now, honestly, Jamaicans have this drive, You know when people are like, oh, everything's about sex with Jamaicans, you know what I mean? When you see them jumping off a speaker, landing on a woman, and daggering and all that. But bruv, you know what it is? There's this level of, I don't know, I don't want to reveal my relationship too much, but brother, trust me, man. Find yourself the right Jamaican woman, and you'll actually realize that, boy, you know what, these Essex girls, and that's, most of them are a waste of time. And it's always these overly done ones, you know, they're the ones that don't put it out. The ones that think they're all pretty and that, they don't put it out. The raw things, man, they put it out, fam. They're too much, if she's wearing too much makeup, she don't put it out. You know why? Because that's all she's got.
Yeah.
So I mean, bruv, I've seen chicks that are average.
Yeah.
They will go to Tesco and back with no makeup.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? And you know, funny enough, me and my brother were talking about this the other day, and my missus is going to kill me for this, but like, he was like, there's a difference in women. You know, you can see the real woman when she's not done up,
yeah.
But you see her walk into the shop, she's wearing tracksuit bottoms, but you can see something there.
Yeah,
you
know
what I mean? She might not be the biggest in chest, yeah, or vice versa. You know what I mean? But you see the real woman there.
Right.
If you can fancy that woman there,
yeah,
then you got no problems.
I agree.
But other men only see them chicks with makeup, fam.
Yeah. It's why Instagram is bad, because
they're
only showing the best. Because
they're all like this and all that, yeah? But you don't put it out.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Well, we're not... if you're not willing to show the real side of you, what are we getting?
The fake chicks on Instagram, bruv, it's all is you see, the worst place to even look for women is there. And all these younger guys and all that, they're all on social media finding women.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? And it's dangerous, bro. You're getting catfished. This chick turns up and the ass is 20% less than you saw on the thing, you know what I mean?
Or 20% more.
Or 20% more, yeah. You know what I mean? It weren't what you thought you were seeing, you know what I mean? But bro, yeah, man. Me personally, my message to men, don't feel forced to go into relationships or feel forced to... If you sense any paranoia in that relationship, it needs to be addressed.
Mm.
Straight up.
Yeah.
Relationship advice. Wicked.
This is why I love the barbershop, because we can get real insights.
Yeah, and you know what? This is the first podcast I've been on where I feel like we've actually... like you took something from the barbershop, brought it right to the table.
That's what I like.
And we've freely spoken about it.
Yeah, because that's what the idea is. We're bringing the barbershop to people that don't get to experience the barbershop. And sometimes, like, so this discussion we've had now, if I want a female opinion, I'll take it to my Instagram. I'll put it on the story and I'll say, girls, DM me if you can help me with this situation. Mm-hmm. So I can bring that advice back to the guys, because sometimes we've got like a bunch of guys discussing the same thing about women.
Yeah, and no female
and we ain't women. So we could really miss something.
Yeah.
But it, you know, everybody loves to hear barbershop conversations because they're as honest and raw as it can get.
Yeah.
And we're not trying to hype shit up for fun. This is just a real conversation.
It's real conversations, it's real things that people are living, man.
You know, and this is why, like, I encourage guys, if you're willing to talk to your barber about problems, do it, because you can gain so much out of it.
Yeah.
But at the same time, we're not experts. So if we tell you something and it doesn't hit the way it's meant to,
I'm an expert. Get a Jamaican woman. Nah, I'm joking. But nah, honestly, we're not experts. But bro, sometimes you don't need an expert. You just need someone that's lived through it.
Yeah.
That's the best expert you can get.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
You can't get someone that studied football and you know, watched videos and studied it, and he's telling you something. What about the guy that actually played it?
Yeah.
He will tell you, all right, cool. You know, when you're knackered and you can't move your limb and you can't position yourself in a certain way so you ain't got a chase. You know what I mean? It's experience.
Yeah, when you're watching sport and you've always got somebody that's like, and he's pointing the finger, and it's like, have you done that sport?
Yeah,
like,
yeah.
Are you well trained? Exactly.
Oh, he's a shit boxer. Bro, have you been punched in the face for 12 rounds before, bruv? Like, you know what I mean? Yeah. Whilst moving about and the stamina and, you know what I mean? Everything that counts, you know what I mean? We, as an audience, you can say what you want, but you got to listen to the people, man. You know what, yeah? So many men are doing crazy stuff to themselves these days, man. You know what I mean? And a lot of it is based around women.
Yeah,
it's so true, and man. Insecurity and that, bro. If you feel insecure with your woman, you need to talk to her. If you can't talk to her, leave. Yeah. If she's not willing to talk, leave. Because every other minute after that, you're digging your own grave, man. Yeah, trust me, man. And it's so true. What's the one thing that can break the strongest men? Women.
Yeah.
By nature, they're designed to. That's why women can press that button.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
This is a thing. Like, some of these guys, they're coming in and they're normally happy, confident guys. They've got a problem with their missus. Mm-hmm. And these guys are sitting in the chair and they're deflated.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm like, fucking hell.
Yeah.
Like, this is because it doesn't, after the conversation, the problem is still there. He's at work. He's still thinking about it.
Yeah.
He goes, sees his boys, his barber, whatever. He's still thinking about it. So you've got to fix the problem. Don't expect that, like, oh, we just kind of put a plaster on it, it'll heal. It don't heal. Because,
and you know, as well, men always, there's this conception that it's always men that go and fuck about and all this, yeah? Brother, there's women out there that are willing to be with a man, have a child, have a house together, everything, and they wouldn't even love you like you think they do, but it's just to keep their family happy or to keep their friends happy because they're in a competition because Sarah's got married and they've renovated a house and they got a pool in the back.
Hitting home. Like, you know what I mean? I know people exactly that, you know. People,
you know what I mean? Living for society, bro.
Yeah.
Come on, you man. Know, come on, man.
There's stories, and I'm telling you, because I know people in it, where they're unhappy, yet they're not confident to leave because they'll be unstable financially, so they'll just stay.
Stay, yeah.
So that person's unhappy, the person they're with is unhappy.
Mm-hmm.
Pointless.
Mate, most of the couples in London, my personal observance, if that's even a word, observance, wow, you can tell I ain't slept. A lot of these relationships, especially when you're in London, you just stand there and you watch, a lot of them are fake.
Mm.
You know what I mean? Yeah. It's because it's the norm to have a boyfriend 9 to 5 and he works in Canary Wharf, I work here, and then we've got a house together, da, 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 da. But you don't even see each other.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Then where's the relationship?
It's for sure.
You both work for 2 weeks away in Greece or something every year. That's it. Because when you're both back, you're both stressed in your jobs. Da, 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 da.
Yeah,
you
know, but it's so on Christmas Day, they can wear matching pajamas, and on Valentine's Day, they can post their roses, and that's why they do it. But they're willing to do it with the wrong person just so they've got that.
Intentionally don't do nothing on Valentine's Day.
Right.
And I think it's because it's one thing that we share in common where it's like, we don't understand why we should pick one day to do. You never see certain man them in a restaurant with their girlfriend, but on Valentine's Day.
Yeah. Social norms, innit?
Certain man them are taking a picture just so that other chicks can see it on the Snap. Man takes chicks to Gauchos, what man got the beamer, And girls go out with other guys just to make other guys jealous.
Yeah.
Bro, it's a dangerous game out there, guys, man. Trust me. When I was in a deep, and I know we're running for time here, but just one last thing. When I was in a deep space years ago, which is what actually led to me starting Barberstop, because I was suffering with depression, anxiety, and stress at the same time. I didn't even know.
Okay.
One thing I'll never forget, the psychologist told me, psychiatrist or whatever, shrink, I'll call him. She said, you need to be selfish.
Yeah. Sometimes you've got to.
Bro, how many people tell you in your life, don't be selfish?
Yeah.
It's bullshit.
Yeah.
You got to be selfish. Look at Ronaldo, one of the selfish characters you'll ever see in your world. I feel like he's selfish to his own kids.
Right.
You know what I mean? But look at him.
Yeah.
Because he's developed himself. Yeah. It's all about him. Because if you don't develop this, what use is it to her?
Yeah.
Or to him? Or, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
You need to be you. Because if that chick dumps you one day, you got your whip that still makes you feel confident. You can jump in your whip, go to a next club, go out with your mates, drive to Amsterdam with your mates. You know what I mean? You got your house or you've got your room that you're renting.
Yeah, yeah.
You're independent, bro.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Don't go and get a house with a woman, share the bills, and she don't even love you, bro. But you're living in London paying $2,000 a month on rent.
Yeah.
And you're eating microwave meals because she can't cook.
Yeah.
But you didn't know that.
But it's everything you're not happy with. But now you're at a point where you're like, you know what? I'll just settle because I've been here for 6 months. I've been here 12 months. And it's long for me to start again. So even though I'm not happy, I'll just stay.
Yeah. Dead. You know what I mean? A lot of people do it with kids. A lot of people do it because of the financial instability. Yeah. But why? You're signing yourself into a contract.
Life's too short to be unhappy, man.
Bro, I'm telling you now. Trust me, it's too short to be unhappy, man. Definitely.
That's it.
But yeah, man, that's some deep conversation. My blood is boiling, fam. You done a job there, bruv. You proper brought that barbershop conversation. Well, it's just us two in here. I feel like Mandamin and we just had a
You don't need it to be like it's, you know, it's just two guys talking real life is what the barbershop is. And it's what we're trying to bring to the podcast.
Mm-hmm.
Before we wrap up, is there anything you want to plug? The socials.
Shout out to Alpha Male Barbers. It's been about 5 years waiting. Finally here, man. Shout out to Van Damme. He's a real one. If I had to count on one hand, he'd probably be in the top five of barbers that I keep close to me, just because of the type of conversations I've had with you, the way you come across and the way you hold yourself.
Thank you, man. I respect that.
Barberstop UK is not that I'm plugging myself. Every barber that you see on that page, stories on the page, wherever. If you see me tagging a barber, that's a barber worth following, man. Trust me, man. So. We're representing the barbers, or representing the urban public, man. So,
yes, indeed. I'll tag the socials for everybody, anybody watching. Subscribe, like, follow us on the socials, and the videos. I'm trying to get more podcasts out. I'm trying to get more guests out.
We're coming back. I'm coming back here, bro. Yeah. I need another one, man. Yeah, man.
Well, the next one, Romeo the Barber, get ready.
Yeah.
So we'll be linking up again in a couple of weeks.
Definitely, man.
Thank you very much for watching. My name is Bandy Golal, Theo Barberstop UK, in the chair with the barber. Stay tuned, and you'll see me soon.
Alpha. Yeah. Male.